5 minutes before, give a friendly reminder, because I know that many of you need to like get and run and everything, and then we can take questions and all, just to make sure that we get in together. So the study of semiotics, how many of you have studied semiotics in your other classes? Absolutely. How many of you have studied semiotics outside of communication studies? Okay. Interestingly, semiotics, of course, grounded in this communication studies because we are constantly pulling apart and making sense of communication, of words, of language, of behaviors, of actions. But semiotics can exist within many other disciplines, and even if you did a little Google of semiotics and education, it's like how we're using semiotics to explain. I saw something the other day, how we use semiotics to explain the relationship between teachers and non-native English speakers. So it's simply like how, I mean, very interesting, that relationship, how they are viewing like their disposition, how they view them as teachers, and it's definitely by these choices of like language, how they view their effectiveness in certain situations. It's fascinating to see. So like strategies for education, strategies of course for politics or economics, what, how do we want to use this communication? How do we want to effectively get our message across, I guess. So the two theorists that we will concentrate on, although there are many others who have contributed to the idea of semiotics, come from our French theorists, so Saussure and Barlow. Are you all looking at the reference? You know when you see something 18 times, you're like, fork. Yeah. Fork. Is that how it's spelled? All right, there we go. So, where one individual simply studied signs and symbols as its own, the next individual came in and took those signs and symbols and added on the idea of myth, ideology, and created this essence of looking at signs and meaning and how we use signs to create meaning and how multiple meanings can come out of one specific sign. So I bring us to this picture. Is anybody familiar with this photograph? Do you know of it?
Or I forget what it means. I've seen it many times. I'm assuming that's in French.
It is.
I don't know what it says or means. If you tell me, I'll probably remember.
Absolutely, yes. So what we're looking at is a picture, and if I was like, okay, well, what is this a picture of, y'all? It's a picture of a?
Pipe.
Absolutely, but if you are lucky enough to speak French, and you do know the translation, in fact, it says, this is not a pipe. Yeah.
Was it in the Fallmer Stars? Didn't they use it?
In the which one?
In the Fault in Our Stars.
Oh, I never saw the Fault in Our Stars. Tell me. I'm sure they did.
I think they did.
Were they at the museum?
I don't know. They were on a plane.
Oh, okay.
And then like Ansel Elgort like has like a cigarette, but he's like, I'm not lighting it, so it like can't kill me. And then like, I don't know, it was something like that. But I don't know if it was a pipe. Now I feel like it's wrong. But I swear.
No, but I'm loving it. And if you learned the concept or idea from the Fault in the Stars. It's okay. I didn't know, like, really sincere.
I'll Google. I'm gonna do it.
Right? Yeah. That's a really fun one, though. If it is.
I hope it is.
Yeah, so the idea is that if you saw this in a museum, and it brought about great thought for quite some time, that this is not a pipe. Really generates, and I think that the fun part, let me just grab like these ideas. What they want you to, of course, start to do is take a second and think about what we look at, if you will. It can be interpreted in many ways, according to the viewer. Many of us would come to the conclusion with pipe, of course. But this is not a pipe. All that is, let me go back. Paint on a canvas. right? So not a pipe, but paint on a canvas. You can't fill that with tobacco and smoke it. Part of its definition, right? Did you have an idea? Okay, good. But the painting, what it does is it really encourages the viewer or whoever's receiving this message to really like free the mind. And that was the purpose. Wanting us to start to look at what types of human shortcuts we take in order to understand something. Or how does our mind take shortcuts to accept the chain of messages that we are receiving, right? So we take our, if it says this is not a pipe, right? It gives us that idea of then, well, what is it? And they don't necessarily want you to answer then, what is it? Like this philosophical question of like, is the table, is this a table, right? With ideas, but instead, well, then what is it? And starting to take in that idea of maybe there could possibly be another way to look at this or an alternative way of thinking. And so what makes this particular piece so intriguing is to know that many viewers were kind of left with that idea, or I guess the question of, we don't really know things that we think we know a lot about. Do we know the things that have been set up and established as things we should know? Yeah, absolutely. But is that knowing really knowing? We oftentimes only come to know what we have the language to describe. The only way that you all said the word pipe is because we have created that word as something for, you know, that represents this thing that you put tobacco in and go. But we really only have access to our images if we have this like language to go along with them. Language is the way that we can express what we are seeing or the world around us. And so when we speak, often we speak with the belief that I am telling you something and you are going to get exactly that same thing that I was talking about. But in actuality, that is not true. We know that is very true in the long-standing world of communication that we live in. And so this gives us a great springboard for our discussion of semiotics, this idea of language and starting to take it apart. Oh, you know why, Chloe? It's because we did this semiotic. I used this in semiotics in 1600.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Riveting. Clearly, so memorable. Just kidding.
Because I also learned about semiotics last semester. I knew it was from one of my classes. I just didn't remember which one.
You know, I was just trying to think. I was like, oh, yeah, wait, because I used to use this one in 1600. Okay, well, now we get it. Semiotics. And we're not going to go into the 1600 of semiotics. Don't you worry. We're talking about the ease of semiotics for popular culture in our way. So, not only does it start to ask us, well, if I don't have the language to express what I am seeing, then there isn't a way to necessarily like put a name to it, but we also start to examine some of the other elements that go along with what we think we know. So for example, if I say this is not a cow, now instead you would say it is
a picture
of a cow, right? And this cow is really just one of the many different types of cows. But beyond the cow, beyond what it is, what we will start to look at with semiotics is beyond just being able to identify a cow, with that image or with that language comes a myriad of other ideologies that exist with the particular thing. It's only a cow, sure. But if we think about our audience and we think about the long-standing relationship that we have with cows in the United States, there's this fascinating like statistic about like how much we see cows, something like, I don't know, like 500 times in a month or something like that. And it's if you think about it, where we see cows all the time in commercials or wherever, right? We see or are exposed to cows and what they look like, etc. But the big thing that I want us to pick out here is what are some of those ideologies that go along with it? So we see that it is a cow, but when individuals see this, it may be something else as well. There's a lot of political ideology that goes along with the cow. So for example, if somebody is a vegan, absolutely, Nikki. So if somebody's a vegan, then they will see the cow and it brings about feelings of? Okay, potentially the food industry, right? The value of an animal's life, that dialectic that that humans do not have the power over an animal. What about like from a religious perspective? In what religion or any types of religions see a cow as a sacred piece? Yeah, absolutely, right? So in this case, looking at a cow who's tagged and potentially all we're seeing is this cow out in, you know, nature. That's one of those things too, is that this cow looks very much different than many of the cows that we probably see here in California. How many of you see cows just out ranging, flowing in the grass? Okay, go ahead.
I grew up in Dallas.
Ah! Okay, and so you see a lot of cows. I don't know about y'all. For me, the cows that I typically will see will be driving up the 5 freeway, right? And you're cruising up over Bakersfield, and you're like, what the f- that smell? You're like, oh my gosh, cows. And then typically they're in these like little containers and these barns and whatever, right? And it's dusty and it's dirty and it's in the middle of wherever. And so the idea of a cow and how we represent a cow to you is incredibly important as well. Because this cow looks happy, looks taken care of, looks well done, like looks like it's, you know, out enjoying the sunshine. And so when you're saying happy cows come from California, you best believe this is the picture, not that one from the 5 freeway, right? Because that's not the happy cow that I'm thinking of. And I don't want to drink that cow's milk. So we can think about it that way. Socially, do you think there's any like social issues with cows? Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Oh my gosh, I love that. I didn't even think of that. Awesome. Absolutely. So we can use cow, and if you have had somebody, you know, slay terrible words at you your whole life about making a comparison to an animal, then yeah, that's interesting. A great way that we could look at it. And they would probably respond much differently to that meaning and what it is. Oh, I love it. Good, good. And then of course I have on here personal as well, but those could be like any of these ways. Maybe you were, you know, chased down by a cow at one point. I don't know. Or like you've had a bad experience, right? Like, who knows? Lots of people have had all of those different types of things. But the important thing here is that what we want to start to do is start to pick apart what we are seeing. This is an advertisement. Sure. Is it? Oh, it's an advertisement selling me something. But what is it even beyond that? And how we start to examine that and how we start to get to it is through those elements called signs. And so let's look at these things called signs. We talked a little bit about them last time. We talked a little about how these signs are utilized. If you recall, we talked about signs in the form of rhetoric. Like, what are these symbols, including language, right? That there's numerous ways that we can present our ideas or our understanding of things or communicate, if you will. So the first one is language. Letters, and we know this, any form of language is going to have a particular type of symbolic representation for their words, for their letters. And so language is just one way for you to know what we are talking about. We can use that commonality. The other thing is visuals. We know that we can use a picture of something that evokes the idea about something. So I'm using this very simple example of a dog. I can say the word dog, right, to communicate what I'm meaning, or I can show you a visual of potentially what I mean. That could be a sign. I can also do a physical action right? I could do something like, mind the dog, and you could guess what I'm doing, right? If you wanted to do that, get down on the ground, pretend, right? These are ways that I can tell you what I'm representing. We do it all the time, and you're like, no, it's that circle thing, and you go like this. The game, what is it? Right? Hold on. Okay, good. Do you get that? Okay, oof, I was nervous. Like, I gotta work on my skills. All right, and then the last thing are natural signs, and your text talks a lot about this. Things that happen within nature that are giving us an indication, typically we call these causal signs. If I see smoke, there's typically a fire below that. If I see puddles on the ground, it is a sign that there was, you know, rain, or perchance somebody was like washing. If it's clear skies, and you're like, what's, maybe somebody's washing something if it has soap in it, right? Those are signs that something else is happening or going on. So we'll remember these signs and the ways that they are, used, and how we use the many variety of signs in order to communicate. And remember that when we're looking through this, gestures, facial expressions, so when we start to look at advertisements or we start to look at media, all those things are going to be very important. The physical actions, the visual, the language, to put all the pieces together and understand what, in fact, the intended message was. So modern semiotics took a second, and really in 1916, that's where this started to go about. So that's modern political times. And so in modern political times, anybody want to give an idea about what the idea of truth was during modernism? Kind of took a step back. Modernism also, like in terms of like art, went back to reflecting the value of high art, coming out of an Enlightenment period as well. But really looking at truth having grounding, being less relative, if you will, more of an objective truth. So looking at language and using the term sign for the first time when it's trying to describe it, and really is trying to put a finger on what was happening and how words were getting broken down and how multiple meanings were being. So what he did within this book was came up with the two terms that we now still use, signifier and signify. Every single sign that you have is going to be made up of two parts, the signifier and the signified. That's the physical form of the sign that we're talking about. So let's break that down really quickly in case anybody needs a friendly reminder. Signs, two parts, signifier, signify. We're not going to do that one. We'll do this one. So the signifier, this is the physical form of the sign. So if I write the word D-O-G, the sign is trying to communicate what I am telling you about, right? I say the word dogs, D-O-G. The letters, the sound, the string of words that create a common communication. Because all of us is a shared community speaking English and living in, speaking and writing English, know that this is the word for that represents dog. So the signifier, it's the thing that usually does the thing standing in for something else. So instead of that actual thing, the mammal with four legs, right, and a tail, we utilize the word, and that becomes our signifier. So usually the word is going to be your signifier, or the symbol, but we'll talk about that in a second. And then in turn, there's the signified, and I mean, come on. Anytime I can bring in a picture of a dog, dogs, puppies, just do it. All right, so the signified, in turn, is the concept, the signifier, Amanda, I wrote that wrong, refers to. You go ahead and take that out if you can, so remember. So the signified is the concept the signifier refers to. So this is the idea that I'm trying to communicate. I'm saying dog, and I have a picture of a dog in my head. You know, that four-legged animal that wags a tail and barks. What's the thing, like I was saying? And when you say dog, yes, dog. We put words to it. So we have the detail, and we have the image in our mind, and then we have the language that supports it. And the idea here is trying to, like, evoke or what our ideas are trying to evoke. Right. So here we have one. What is your signifier? Yeah.
The letters F-A-C-U-N-T-O-R.
And then it spells? There she goes. Yeah, absolutely. You went. Yay, that's a signifier, y'all. So easy, right? Now, Facebook, I have given this to you, but if I said the word Facebook, something else is going to come to mind. And that's going to be your signa? Absolutely. It's whatever that is representing. And so although it may seem easy, like, oh, that app, sure, in each of our minds, our frame of reference, our frame of thought, and the knowledge that we have has all influenced how we're going to see this specific word. And so in turn, Facebook, for your signifier, right, however you come to see and experience and understand Facebook is going to be much different than potentially what I, the intended person, was trying to sell you or was trying to give you information for. So even if we were, even if you just go back to this, because often this is what you'll see on a billboard, right? I'm not going to see what the intended or what the audience maybe thought about the signifier. But the important thing here is that we often, well, that we don't know what those individuals are thinking about that signifier. And that is the one thing that if you're going into marketing or media or PR or advertising, that you want to know, that you're going to seek out. When you see this, how does that make you feel? What are you thinking? What are the ideas that go along with it, right? And so the important part is to ensure that those then people at Facebook go back and when they create the message that those signifiers and the signifieds in fact do line up and they do make sense and that that messaging is put forth in a way that's going to reinforce how they want you to believe about it. So there are three different types of signs. And so even though we talked about like the language, right? So we know that there's all those different vehicles that signs can come in. But they can also be categorized as an index, a symbol, or an icon. Feel free to play along with me here if you want to do one here. An index, like we said, shows evidence of what is being represented. So a good example in this index, this is very much like that what we were talking about before when we went over the four different types. When we're talking about natural signs, indexes are something like this. It's an evidence of what's being representative. I like to say it's a cause effect. That's typically how you can do it. There's something that's causing it and the effect is then that sign. Think about if I'm watching a TV show and I want to talk about evidence of something, what would I like look for? No, that's a terrible question. By the way, I have my answer in my head, but that the question gets you nowhere. Let me think. This is a different way. Let me give you the example, and then you can think of another one. So I was thinking like, oh, okay, if I was trying to talk about something like, you know, how violence is depicted against, you know, anyone or whoever, something like an index could be like a sign of maybe a bruising or a sign of like something that has happened to the body. Does that make sense? That would be a reflection of an effect that would give us insight to maybe the character for what was happening, et cetera. Does that make sense a little bit different? Okay, cool. So put that one in. Anybody else have something they want to play? Put that in. Yeah.
So it's like a smoke or a fire alarm indicating a fire.
There you go, absolutely. So that would be a good one. And how important a fire alarm, for example, Only Murders in the Building, plays as an important piece to the story. Did you ever see the Only Murders in the Building? Did you love it?
Yeah,
it was really good. It's a fun, huh? I like it too. Somebody was interested in Selena Gomez in here, right? From their favorites? Am I crazy on that? Okay. Then we also have icons. So an icon has a physical resemblance to the signified, that thing being represent. So of course, a photograph is a good example of an icon. But what other things are icons? Because you use icons a lot.
Like a logo?
Oh, okay, good. A logo could totally be an icon. So we know the golden arches, right? Another type.
The swoosh.
Right, we put those on particular things. That's going to be really important to know later, product placement, etc. Yeah.
I was thinking of emojis.
Yay! That's where I was going too. It's so fun, right? It's supposed to, because now we've gotten in this cultural language that I know that the right is like wave it or clap. It's not like it's not a poop. It's an ice cream. Oh, okay. Even though it's a poop, right? That we know these common community that they mean what they're saying and they go along with it. So that's a great way to do those types of icons and ways that we do it. And then the last one is what we, of course, have, which is our symbol. And we talked about this as well. And this is more than likely we'll, a combination of these three different types of signs, right? It's what's going to give us a meaning. So a symbol has really no resemblance, if you will, between the signifier and signified. The connection between them must be culturally learned. So numbers and alphabets are always a good number. There's nothing inherent about the number 9 to indicate what it represents. It must be culturally learned. So give me another idea about a symbol per se. So we talked about, Greta, on your shirt, you have a symbol, right? And so unless we know what that symbol is, does it have, I mean, where the reference of the signifier, what is your, do you mind talking about your shirt?
It's a band.
Okay.
Greta Van Fleet.
Oh, like we talked about. But, okay, so the band, Greta Van Fleet. So representative, if we know that, right, those two things together, whatever that signified, perchance, but I don't know that that's doesn't have any connection to the band other than it's created that, right? It's created that symbol. It's almost like Prince when he changed his name and who just went by the symbol formerly known as Prince. So the symbol was what he went as instead, taking away, but it's interesting. He was trying to take away the persona, but can't separate from Prince, man. Anywho, so in that case, these symbols typically have to be learned, typically have to be known and come to understand that way. And a lot of our symbols in society have been done that way. We did that with the peace sign, with the two, right? And with the fight on. So all of those things simply have been learned in our own way and going about it. So Julia, so Julia, you did your things that make you go, hmm. Will you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. Both of them?
Or actually tell me about the, well, do you mind showing the, I can pull it up. Why don't I show it first?
Okay.
The commercial?
Yeah.
Would that work? And then you can explain what you thought. Which is a whole shtickle right now. Let's see. This one?
Yeah, it's that one.
If you haven't seen it. I loved what you said, and so I felt like it really liked it.
Beginning to feel like a rap god, who thinks that arms are long enough to slap spot. Will there be truth for the blueprints? Some page and youthful exuberance. Everybody loves to root for a nuisance. Hit the earth like an asteroid, need nothing but shoot for the moon sense. Ah, summon, I'm a human, I'm a human, assuming I'm a human. What I gotta do to get it through to you? I'm superhuman, innovative, innovative, rubble, so that anything you say is taken, shaken off of me, and it'll move you and devastating. Well, I know the haters are forever waiting for the day that they can say I fell off.
No, 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 no.
Yeah. Hey, I remember syrup sandwiches and crime allowances, finessing on them with some counterfeits, but now I'm counting this Parmesan with my accountant lips and holla. Be humble, holla. Sit down, holla.
And like it made you watch it?
Yeah, I watched it in full because it was pretty interesting.
Because it started.
Yeah,
okay.
the way it started. I mean, it was pretty cinematic as a whole, but I think what really stuck out to me was the symbolism of the chess pieces throughout the entire commercial. Because like it starts off with like, you know, the small city and then like a large hand placing down a chess piece, and then it keeps reoccurring throughout the entire commercial. And then by the end, you see like, oh, they're all convening in Los Angeles, and they're all being placed there. So it just made me think of like why they chose that symbolism to use, like a chess piece, and then it made me think of like power and power structure.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So it was just very thought provoking. I thought there was a lot of like symbolism throughout the entirety, and yeah, that was the main thing.
Great. I loved that you picked this. I think it's such a great example of the proliferation of signs. I mean, it is science, the whole thing. Nobody's saying, technically, that it's not like the message is being communicated so visually. Mm-hmm. I'm going to assume that anybody who has a love of, you know, hip hop and rap music, specifically this West Coast, has also so many things that they could pick apart in this. But the specific thing that I really love was these chess pieces. And that's why I had you talk about this one, because of the symbol. But man, I mean, you can do everything in this. You could do class, you could do materialism, you could do race, you could do identity, you can do feminism. I mean, it is all there. Branding, the whole thing is there. It's really, really great. And those symbols bring up something, and I realized that I didn't even put it on your PowerPoint, but the two concepts that I really wanted to make clear here, and I will make sure, let me make a note, and I will put it in our PowerPoint just so that you can at least. But the syntagmatic and the paradigmatic ways of signs. And these are so paradigmatic, coming from these paradigms, if you will. Paradigmatic, we'll look at this. Will be the first one that we look at. And paradigmatic is something that Chad and I went and Chad brought home a case because we just get all the Super Bowl stuff, right? So I dumped it. I drank it, I'm just kidding. I dumped it right before I got in here. And got me started thinking about this paradigmatic. So did anybody read through that in the text, want to describe what maybe that is? And it's really the way that we read signs. And that's what I wanted to talk about a little bit. So how are we reading these signs? How does the average mind start to read it and make it come together. So messages are constructed with these two concepts either in mind. So the paradigmatic means that signs, well, really, let's do the first one because that's going to be the more important. So your so this is the relationship relationship between signs where they are connected and meaning is made at end. So this is that idea that once I put all the signs within its place, it will start to make sense. But it only makes sense if following a particular structure. So if I say something like, that dog over there, I should probably speak quiet at the library, that dog over there, right? It only makes sense in as much as I say, oh my gosh, I want that dog over there, period. Now that you have received the whole message, now that you have understood it, you're able to get what we're talking about. Think about it even in a speech form, right? Like every sentence is there to provide us with meaning. And by the time you get to the end of the sentence, now the concept has come together. Rather than the individual word creating things, if you will. So the sentence creates the meaning. So if we're looking for something like, I want to examine this piece of prose or poetry or a monologue or, you know, a scene in something, we would look at it in those ways. But when we can break it down, that's when our signs, paradigmatic, become symbols or signs, if you will, become replaceable. And we can take them out to start to create meaning in different ways. And so what that ultimately is going to mean is that rather than having to write you out something that says the Super Bowl is in Los Angeles at the SoFi Stadium, it is going to be sponsored, right? It's an entire thing. Let me instead put it to you in a variety of signs to create an entire, what? Message, right? And so this messaging has a lot of different signs on there that each of us are familiar with, right? Whether it be the Los Angeles Courthouse, the SoFi Stadium, the palm trees, and all those different things that we can start to recognize as being inherent to Los Angeles, right? And that couples with this idea of LA. We have our Super Bowl symbols, the Super Bowl logo, the Bud Light logo. I mean, there's a lot of different signs and symbols with here working to create a message of for Bud Light. And I think this is like the coolest Super Bowl beer I've seen. I will say that. But, I mean, even in all these things, it's crazy to see the Super Bowl oh my gosh, what's it called? So, if you can't find the language, let me describe it for you, everybody. Maybe it'll come in your head. What's that thing where there we go. It's a style guide. You should see the style guides. Like what colors you can. You know, the font, the whatever, the vision, etc. Every last color, every last font, every last choice is done strategically with the greatest intent to have you remember that this is the superest experience, right? And bring you about whatever they want you to feel for LA and that type of vibe, because there's a theme and a vibe that they want to go for. So those two things you can often relate to how we read these, right? So is it meant to be read in context, right? Or is it meant also, or is this intended to be a mix and a myriad of different kind of symbols and signs to come together? So signs rely on convention, something broadly recognized in society. So we all have learned and shared understanding of how signifiers and signifiers go together. That's how we are here even just existing, how you can drive down the street and understand what you're doing, or you know, navigate your way around a school, become a social entity. In every society, there is a broadly recognized way of specific signs. But within any society also, those signs have different meanings. And those come from the things like denotation and connotation. And basics from, you know, the elementary school days are denotation. If we remember that dictionary word, dog, think of it like a noun. And the denotative meaning is actually what it literally is. Domesticated carnivorous mammal that typically has a long snout and an acute sense of smell and barking, howling, or whining voice. That is how it is described in the dictionary. So, but if we had to think about the connotation, what is the connotation of the word? It is the, and it doesn't have to be the perfect definition, but anybody fill in? The associated meaning, good. The various social overtones, cultural implications, or emotional meanings associated with a sign. So these connotations can exist well within the realm of a social group or a specific culture, or it can also reside within the individuals themselves. If I say the word dog, what comes up in your mind may be something very different based upon, again, your experiences and what you have. And so that's why we put this dog. Maybe you've had a bad experience with the dog, you don't like a dog, but the same things happen as if I said the word, perchance, Cocker Spaniel, right? And I've been more specific. So now do you have the same image in your head? Sure, we may have a different image of what that dog is in our head, but it may look somewhat, it's going to certainly look different, and then you're going to have a lot of different ideas as to what a Cocker Spaniel was for you, right? Like, oh, that dog that pees, or that one that's hyper, or that one that's like lazy, or has goop in their eyes. I had Cocker Spaniels, I'm just thinking of what people say, right? So like whatever those particular like characteristics or qualities are. And so, where this moves us into is code. So in retrospect, where we've gone here today is we've talked a little bit about semiotics and where it came from. Then we broke down semiotics and we talk about how it's, you know, signifier and signified, and that's what makes up a sign. And we talked that there are different types of sign indexes, and we talked about symbols, and we talked about, icons, thank you everybody, icons. Huh? And then we talked about those two different ways, the paradigmatic and the signomatic, not even a word, different ways of reading those signs and how those connotations and denotations are typically what will impact the way that we start to see that meaning. So when we talk about that connotation, that's really what we want to get into in terms of these ideas of codes. And so the codes is really something about how we think about our societal way of reading and how we determine these meanings or these connotations, these codes. Codes are, in fact, systems of communication. So if you think of coding, right, like we know that coding is a type of communication, a bunch of ones and twos, and tabbing creates an entire world for you. But codes, the way that we code, is we have our own schemas, and we can think of it like a code X. Do you know what a code X is? A codex would be think about like the original motion picture. Is that Dan Brown book? You were there, right? Are you seeing me do this? Yeah, and you understand what I'm doing, right? Right. Oh, ciphers. So you have ciphers, and it helps you to determine what the actual meaning of it, everything is, and it has to do with like codes, right? So each of us has codes that we've already programmed our brain with. These codes tell us how to read different situations. They tell us how to read different pieces of material that come in contact with us. But they're a learned set of signs. They're general maps of meaning that we have that we know how to function in the world. But codes are where like our semiotics and our ideologies come to meet. And so when we're talking about Barth, we're talking about his building upon those two traditional pieces of signifier and signified, and how he brings those down into something called a myth. And typically our codes are what will allow us to read messages, but also we are gaining a new code in this class and through our education that we will be able to read our materials differently, if that makes sense. So codes were developed by cultural studies scholar Stuart Hall. And Stuart Hall is somebody that we'll talk about a little bit later on as well. But he was the one who really came up with this idea of encoding and decoding and putting those concepts together. So when we talk about encoding and decoding, and hopefully you've heard these terms before, that's really where he is at. He's going. So encoding and decoding, and for any of you who took a media theory class, you may very much remember this idea of encoding and decoding. So encoding, a sender creates a message using signs to package the message. So, and then on the decoding, the recipient of the message interprets it. You may remember this very simply from your maybe first communication class where you learned about this like the linear model of communication. Back in the day when media scholars were first starting to look at media studies, this idea of the hypodermic needle theory was really what was examined, that the TV would give you a message and that the consumer would take it in, absorb it, accept it as true, and move along. Sender, channel, receiver, right? So who's ever sending the message, the channel being the TV or whatever media, and the receiver, you at home getting that information. But Stuart Hall was like, no, I mean, you're encoding it and they're decoding it, but can we assume that the intended message is the one that is being received? And so that's where he started to account for other elements, and those other elements of his process in this theory of encoding are decoding is what allows us to start to examine those underlying ideologies, or as Barr says, these ideas of myths that become collected in our thoughts and in our popular culture as, in fact, truth and as natural. And so communication is the process, is how he looks at it, of messages and meaning being organized through codes. And really, that's what's happening. You have to learn how to decode it. And there are two determinate moments where meaning is made, and that's through the encoding and decoding. So meaning is made on both ends rather than just on one. Oh, sorry, I pushed this. There we go. So Stuart Hall, and if you haven't seen this before, simply something to keep in mind. And I see that we are going through, we're really getting to our time here. So I'll end with this idea for the day and then we'll pick it back up. If you'll see on both sides, the processes of encoding go the same. Now this was done in media, but we can take this and we can look at this encoding and decoding in many ways. And if you've taken any other classes, you know that you can apply these to other things too. But there are so many pieces that go into the creation of a message to take into consideration before we look into it. So we look at things like technical infrastructure. So the first thing that we start to look at are things like, well, who in the world is putting this out, right? So what is it maybe the broadcaster that is projecting the message? Is it the media company that is setting up the idea, right? All of those things are going to have determining factors along it. Then there's the relations of production. How does this get made? How does this information, if we have a particular broadcaster and that person can't do it that day, then we have to choose somebody else. And does that person have a particular face, sound, look, credibility of their own that's going to perpetuate this message and work right? What are the frameworks of knowledge that our audience needs to know or needs to have before they understand this message? Are all the codes there? Will they have knowledge, recollection, investment, understanding of these symbols and the different signs? So once that goes in, then it provides us with some kind of, as they say, meaningful discourse. But that would be your television program, your song, your advertisement, etc. And then the decoding goes the same way. The first thing it goes to you, it goes through all your frames of knowledge. What do you know about the world? And then you start to decode it with what you know, with what resources you have, with what tools you have. It's why you are more than likely not interested in your parents' programming when you are younger, right? Because those topics and those issues and those ideas aren't things that you even have a frame of reference for yet. And it doesn't really make, so it's not engaging, it's not entertaining. The way that you will filter that through is going to be different. The relations of production. The other thing may be, now we know how things are made, right? So on our end, I can start to see, oh, well, who is this company that's making this? Who is this person that's saying that? How is that going to influence the way in which I now see that message? When I know that, like, labor laws were violated, or when I know that that individual was just accused of sexual assault, how does that now make me look at this message? Some of you talked about the Peloton ad and the Peloton issue with, like, TV shows, and now another TV show has shown somebody having a heart attack on a Peloton. And so it's like this whole thing that's coming around with their branding, right? So how do we know this? And then finally, that technical infrastructure. What type of ways are we getting that media? How are we getting it? How is that, in fact, impacting? Who gets access to it? Maybe we don't have, maybe I'm only listening to it through one particular view, right? So there's so many different elements that we can start to look at and that we can start to take into consideration. We're not only putting in the meaning, but also starting to deconstruct it. So these bare bones of Stuart Hall and Barthes and Saussure, they will all be individuals that will encourage us to keep going. So the last moment is that meaning is in the discourse. Meaning is constructed within a discourse at encoding and decoding, which you know, and specific discourses, however, may differ, is that what is particularly encoded may not be what is decoded. And we'll talk about some of those fun ones. You can think of that in your mind. First thing to come to my head is that Pepsi ad with the Jenner, with Kendall Jenner and the Pepsi and offering. I was like, oh boy, that one hit big flats. And there's been lots of flats in the world. Those are the ones where you're like, ooh, yeah, I didn't get that message. Right? What we ended up getting was a different one. Anywho. With our couple minutes left, anybody have any outstanding ideas, thoughts, questions that you wanted to talk about? Or yeah, go ahead, Nikki.
I have a discussion for this week again.
Yes.